Okay, so Kritika, what have you understood about the question so far? What we have to do over here to find the reaction force at the hinge?
Yes, sir. So first, the weight of the rod is going to be in the rod ke middle point. And the buoyancy force is going to be in the length of the water in the middle point. Then we have to equate the torque.
Okay, so we have to balance the torque. And by balancing the torque, what we'll get? We'll get alpha, right? We'll get the unknown angle. Okay.
Yes.
First thing you have to find out is that unknown angle alpha. And then what we have to do for finding the reaction force? Because reaction force to torque equation mein nahi rahega na. So we still have to find the reaction force.
Okay. So reaction force means where it will act?
See, the rod is hinged na, at the corner.
Yes.
Like there's a pin or a nut or a or something like that. Na? So, uske through jo contact force hai, that is what we call the reaction force over here. Correct?
Okay.
So, whatever contact or reaction force is acting at the hinge, it is not creating any torque. Na?
Yes.
So, it is not going to come in your torque equation, but you will still have to solve the torque equation to find out. Now, you will understand which equation will tell me how much the reaction force is. So, this is what kind of situation? Rigid body in equilibrium. Correct?
Yes.
So rod एक rigid body है जो कि equilibrium में, so obviously torque is zero, but we have one more thing ना, apart from torque what else is zero? The net force is zero.
Yes, so that the reaction force at the hinge will be balancing the apparent weight of the rod.
Yes, correct. Okay, it will be balancing the apparent weight. That's correct. Good. So now based on that you work this out. Okay, how much this is? So still when you balance the force, right, you will see that buoyant force is unknown. Why? Because mujhe ye alpha nahi pata na. So I don't know how much portion is submerged. So directly by subtracting buoyant force minus weight or weight force, whichever be the case, I can't calculate the reaction force. So I first need to find out how much the buoyant force is. So to find out how much the buoyant force is, you need the angle alpha for which you need to balance the torque. So that becomes the two parts of the question. Okay, so I'm just making the free body diagram, but you do the same thing actually. You know, you try out making the FBD yourself and see how you will get the situation.
Yes, sir.
Right, so this is, let's say, my rod, and now we are considering the forces acting through it. So through the center of mass, there will be the weight acting. Then the other forces acting will be the contact force at the hinge and the buoyant force. So let's say the buoyant force is acting through some point over here like this. And let's assume it dominates over the weight. So reaction force will act like this. So these are the three forces which are acting. The reaction force at the hinge, the buoyant force and the weight. Okay. Now about the buoyant force, we'll understand one.
Just one doubt. That reaction force will act on downward or upward direction.
So see, what is happening? Reaction force is balancing the net, no, of the other two things.
Yes.
So if I assume that B is more than mg, then it'll act.
Okay.
If I assume the other way, it'll act like this. Now here, why I'm assuming B is more than mg? You'll understand very easily because buoyant force ka momentum about the hinge kam hai na. You can see the moment arm of buoyant force is less.
Okay.
So that's probably why my assumption is going to be correct. Okay. When I work it out. So let's anyway check it out. So this is the geometry here. So now the next thing is I have to understand the geometry aspect of this. So if the level of water is up to a height of this thing. So the level of water here is up to a height here. Also. Yeah, Arman, I will just share the question very soon with you, the one we are doing. Okay. So this is the level of water. This angle is alpha. This height is given to me. And obviously the length of this thing is known. So the buoyant force will be equal to this thing, the area of cross section into this length. That's a hypotenuse. So this length you can see, this is h. So it is how much? H by sine alpha. So that is the volume of liquid submerged. I mean, volume of solid submerged inside the liquid into density of the fluid into g. Okay, so that is your buoyant force. And your mg is of course given to you, but in general mg is A into L into density of the body into g. So this is anyways given to you as 25 newtons in the question. This thing is the unknown thing. Okay. H is given. Okay. Now you have to also understand that the buoyant force is acting through this point, which is the center of this.
Sir, mg will have a component now that perpendicular to the rod.
Ab to theek hai na, but I don't need to break in components. I'll just calculate torque as force into momentum like that. Okay.
Okay.
So the buoyant force is acting through this point. This point here, where the buoyant force is acting, that is the midpoint of which part? It is the midpoint of this part, this whole part.
Okay.
So that's what I have to take care of. So buoyant force ke liye jo momentum hai about this point, about this axis. So buoyant force ke liye jo momentum hai, that is this one. Okay. So that momentum you can see, this is the midpoint of this. So this height is h by 2 from here to here. So this momentum, let's say, is xb. So xb will become how much? Xb will become h by 2 cot alpha. Correct. So this is the buoyant force in terms of the unknown angle alpha. And this is the momentum of the buoyant force in terms of the unknown angle alpha. Okay. Whereas mg is a known quantity. Okay. Now we can see balancing, coming back to the first diagram, we can balance the torque about the hinge. So the hinge is the point O. Okay. So we can come to balancing torque. About the hinge O is zero. So we can see that buoyant force is creating this type of a torque. And mg is creating this type of a torque. And balance these two and use these two values which are written over here. So that will help us find out the value of alpha, which is unknown. And then from that, we will be able to calculate. Okay, so Kritika, I hope you understood the free body diagram, right?
Yes, sir.
Now you continue working on the problem and I will just share the question with Arman so that he is able to understand what we are doing. Okay, so Arman, this is the question. Okay, just go through it and work it out and I'll go through what you are sending also. Okay, so Arman, I have got the doubts you have sent. So I'll be solving them next. Okay, after we complete this problem. So this is the question and you've just seen the free body diagram. I'll come back to that. Okay, so you try working this out first.
The center of emotion, which point is that exactly?
So see, that is what we more commonly call center of buoyancy. Okay, so it is the center of immersion means what? It is the geometrical center, or you can say the centroid of the volume which is submerged.
Okay. So
buoyant force is weight of liquid liquid displaced. No? So the buoyant center, the point through which the buoyant force acts vertically, that will be the center of mass of the portion of liquid you have displaced. So that only they are referring to here as center of immersion. Okay. So the immersed part is the center of mass.
Okay.
Alright, so see all the data that is given to you. length of the rod is given, height of that water surface is given, and weight of the rod is given, and the density of the liquid is given, and area of cross section of the rod is given. So in the diagram I had made earlier, everything other than alpha is known. Okay. So shall I switch to the diagram?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So switching to that now. So you see in this diagram what is happening. H is given to me as 1.6 meters. The length of the rod is given to me as 3 meters. The this thing, density of water or fluid or whatever is given to me. And the weight of the rod is given to me 25 newtons. Okay. And the area of cross-section of the rod, that's also given to me. Okay, I'll just put up the values. But, so now in terms of this, how will I find the reaction force? So what is happening? The left-hand diagram is actually representing the proper free body diagram with all the three forces acting on it shown. So I'll have to assume buoyant force is more than mg because the moment arm for buoyant force is less. So if the torque of buoyant force is balancing the torque of mg, then obviously buoyant force into a smaller moment arm has to balance mg into a larger moment arm. The buoyant force has to be more. The buoyant force agar jyada hai, that means actually the tendency of this rod is to float up, but it is held in place at the hinge. So the reaction force is pulling it down and keeping things balanced. And that's why again the reaction force doesn't have a horizontal component. Right? So with all these things in mind, the free body diagram, including the direction of R, appears to be correct. Okay. Now next thing what we have to do is, we have to balance torque about the point O. So by balancing the torque about the hinge O, we will be able to find out the one unknown in the problem, which is alpha. And the other unknown is of course reaction force. And once we find the unknown of alpha, we can find out buoyant force. From that we can find out reaction force, which is mg minus buoyant force. Or rather buoyant force minus mg. Okay. So we try out the question. I will quickly tell you the values of this thing also. Cross section is 9.5 centimeter square, and G we have to take as 9.8, and density of water is the standard value. Okay, so these are the things you have to. So density of water in this additionally is given, and the area of cross section is given. So this is 1 gram per cc. G we have to take as the more accurate value, and the area was 9.5 centimeters square. Okay. So let's use this data and let's finish off this question. Further up in this diagram, you can see that this is the moment arm of mg. So this angle is alpha. The torque due to mg, which is clockwise, should balance the torque due to buoyant force, which is anti-clockwise. So buoyant force's value, I'm just putting it from there. So it is density of water into G into AH by sine alpha into the moment arm, which is H by 2 cot alpha. This has to be balanced by MG. I'm directly putting it because its value is given to me. Multiplied with the moment arm, which is you can see L by 2 cos alpha. At all this 1000 gram per cc into 9.8 into area 9.5 centimeter square into h square, so that is 1.6 square divided by 2 sine square alpha, because cos alpha will cancel out, is 25 newtons multiplied by V by 2, that's cos alpha cancelled out. So from this you will get the value of sine alpha. from this you find out how much alpha is. And then you substitute the action force as buoyant force minus mg. That is
so this L by 2 into cos alpha, how is that 3 by 2?
Nahi, cos alpha cancel ho gaya beta, because yahan pe cot hai na.
Achha.
So it's just L by 2. The cos alpha. That's why I got sine square alpha in the denominator. Sine alpha from here and one sine alpha from here. So I just done that quick calculation. Okay, but so I'll just put up the values we should be getting.
So is the answer 1.6?
Yes, that's correct. The sine alpha will come approximately 0.56.
0.56.
So sine square alpha here will come approximately 2.6 or something, but the 0.26
is 0.32.
Sorry, 0.32. 0.32 or sine alpha is approximately 0.56. So substitute that over here and you will get the reaction force as 1.6 newtons, correct? And 1.6 downwards. So our assumption was correct.
Downwards.
So that is this question. So, Kritika, are you clear with the full solution now?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, there are a couple of more problems in fluid mechanics I wanted to discuss, but I'll come back to that later. Arman has sent me some doubts, so let me share that first. Let's see if this 11th question. In the following figures, find the magnitude of electric field at the point P on the axis of the square. The distance of P from the center is x. Okay. So in each of these questions, we have to find the magnitude of the electric field, which is, you know, now imagine you are looking at the vertical axis of the square, like the symmetry axis. Okay. And you have to find the field at that point of the axis. Now you'll see that there's some kind of symmetry in each one you can get away with. Okay. So for example,
only the first two I got, in the third one I'm not getting the answer.
You're not getting the answer. Okay, I'll discuss. But in the first one, what method you used?
First one, just a minute.
You can use a potential gradient method. You understanding now? Because first one mein charo positive hai na. So the direction of the field will be along that axis only. So the very clever thing would just make like a ring of total charge 4q, and that ring should have a radius of how much? Half the diagonal, e by root 2. That's one way you could relate it, or just write the potential at that point B as a function of x and then differentiate it. But in the second one, you will understand from symmetry, the two minus q charges are creating a field that is downwards towards that center point. Right? Whereas the two positive charges are creating a field which is away from that. So net field has to become how much? Zero.
Zero.
So you know the first one you still have to do some calculation, but you can get away. So just for critical benefit, I'm working this out. Third one is the one where some more symmetry will have to apply. So I'll just briefly discuss all the parts here. Okay, so coming back to my screen here. So let me basically place the square in the yz plane, suppose, and the x axis is the axis of symmetry. This is the axis of symmetry for my square. So the particles are placed, say, here. So they are forming this square in the yz plane itself. In the first case, these are all positive. So just to reiterate the easy way of doing this question. So when you see any point on the x-axis at x, 0, 0, and these points are at, you know, like this, for example, this is at 0, e by 2, e by 2, because the side length is limited. This is at 0, e by 2, minus e by 2, right? Because side length of the squares are e. So like that, this point and this point. Okay, so you can see the potential at the, so first of all, you can see symmetry wise, the field will have only x component. So that field will actually become minus dv by dx. So this is the easiest way of doing it. You don't have to see any components and cancelling component, adding component, all that. Now V is equal to summation KQ by R. So that is 4 times KQ divided by the distance from each one, which is root of X square plus A square by 2. Not A square by 4, because this is A by root 2. This diagonal distance is A by root 2. So from here you can see this is your right angle triangle.
Yes.
So this little trick is very useful. So now you can see your potential comes to electric field will become 4 kq, you take common outside, into the minus sign. So minus half into x square plus e square by 2 to the power 3 by 2. I think we had discussed a question like this once before also, if I'm not mistaken. So you will get the field very easily as 4 times KQX upon E square by 2 plus X square to the power 3 by 2, where K is 1 by 4 pi epsilon. Okay. And you will see that the field has this kind of pattern. The magnitude of the field versus the distance along the axis is like this. It has a maxima at R by root 2, and R here is E by root 2.
E by root 2.
So this information you already know. Okay. Yeah.
Sir, E will have a component. I mean, if it is along the x-axis, then it will have.
So see, you do one thing about that. That point P, you join it with the four corners of the square where the charges are placed. Okay? So you're getting a regular pyramid.
Yes, sir.
You're getting a regular pyramid, and all of them are positive charges. So yes, all of them are creating field which is repulsive. So they are along the edges of that pyramid. You know? तो जो फोर इलेक्ट्रिक वेक्टर्स है ना वो सब सिमेट्रिकल है विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द एक्स एक्सिस।
हाँ सर सर, बट अगर आप एक 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 पॉजिटिव चार्ज से अगर आप लाइन ड्रॉ करोगे तो वो एक्स एक्सिस को इंटरसेक्ट करते हुए जाएगा, देन इसका जो कंपोनेंट रहेगा एक्स एक्सिस पे।
तो यू कैन डू दैट वे, सो सी ईच चार्ज पार्टिकल इन दिस डायग्राम
सेम आ रहा है,
ईच चार्ज पार्टिकल इज क्रिएटिंग अ फील्ड लाइक इन दिस सॉर्ट ऑफ डायरेक्शन, लेट अस से दैट इज ई1 एंड इट्स मेकिंग सम एंगल लाइक दिस विद द एक्स एक्सिस, सो जस्ट ऐड दैट कंपोनेंट, सो दिस ई कैन आल्सो बी कैलकुलेटेड एज 4 टाइम्स ई1 cos थीटा. It will come that way, and if you check out that way, E1 is kq divided by r square, and that cos theta is how much? That cos theta is x upon r.
Okay.
Because it's this angle only, na? So you can see you have 4 kq x divided by r cube, and r is the same thing. So you again get this one.
Okay.
So that is how you can do it by the component method also.
Okay.
Alright, Tridhira. So hope this is clear. Okay. Now the second part of this question, that diagonally opposite particles were having positive charge and the diagonally opposite particles were having negative charge. So that's also easy part to work out symmetry by, because you realize that there's a cancelling effect. So this time, what was happening is this particle, let's say, is positively charged. So then this particle is negatively charged. And then again, this particle is positively charged. And this particle is negatively charged. That's how the square is. Okay. So this time, no, suppose I name this ABCD. Okay. And then I name this point P, which is at x, 0, 0. And you know, same things for these ones, 0, comma, a by 2, a by 2. Now separately visualize these two triangles. Okay, triangle APC, okay, and triangle BPD. So just visualize them separately. So just separately look at this triangle I'm talking about over here, and you'll understand what I'm saying. So if you visualize this triangle APC, it is something like this. ACP like this, and these two are positive charges. So these two are creating a field which is net like this. So this is the field due to A plus C. Correct. And then that other triangle lies in another plane. In fact, that plane is perpendicular to this one because they are the diagonal planes of the square. But doesn't matter. So just imagine you draw it separately. So now you have BDP.
Minus x.
So exactly ulta ho ja raha hai na. So you can see that they are minus q, and the distances are also the same. These r's are the same. This is the diagonal, so it is a root 2. This is a root 2. This is rr. Everything is the same, but just the direction is. So E due to B plus D will be like this, and they will be same in magnitude. Therefore, your field at the point P, net field, is how much? It's going to be zero. It's going to be another. Right, Tridhika, this is clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now we come to the slightly tricky part where we'll see also what shortcut we can use. But first, let's understand the part itself. Okay. Where now one side is having positive charge and one side is having negative charge for the square. So, we have our. So let's say these two, let's just say, maybe they are the other ones, but it doesn't matter. These two are positively charged. Okay. And the below two, let's say, are negatively charged. These two are negatively charged. Okay. So now let us see what kind of symmetry we can make use of here, if at all there's any symmetry we can make use of. So are you getting an idea about how the direction of the field will look like now at this point. Just visualize this and try to see what kind of direction of field you will get. So again, let's do the same nomenclature, A, B, C, and D. So A and B together are creating what kind of field? That's one way to see. AB ko as a pair dekho or CD ko as a pair dekho, and then another way to do is again see AC as a pair and take BC as a BD as a pair and check it out that way also. Okay, so we'll see
minus if this is bidirection.
AB together is creating along negative bidirection. Very good. And similarly, CD together will create along the negative bidirection. So it'll just be double of. Okay, so that is one way of doing the problem. That if I can by component method figure out what is the negative y component of B's field and the negative y component of A's field, but again you realize there's three dimensionality involved, right? Because if you join the line BP, it is not lying in the XY plane, it is lying outside the XY plane.
Yes.
It's a little bit tricky, you know. Okay, so now let's try the other thing. If I go with AC as a pair and then BD as a pair, so AC as a pair comparatively it has an advantage because it's what type of thing? It's like a dipole.
सर इसमें वायर कंपोनेंट पे कैंसिल आउट हो जाएगा ना
नहीं बेटा कैंसिल नहीं होगा बिकॉज़ यू कैन सी ए एंड बी टुगेदर आर क्रिएटिंग अ नेगेटिव वाई कंपोनेंट बिकॉज़ दे आर क्रिएटिंग रिपल्सिव फील्ड्स ना सो जस्ट विजुलाइज दैट ट्रायंगल एबीपी एंड यू रियलाइज दे आर टुगेदर क्रिएटिंग अ डाउनवर्ड फील्ड ओके दे आर क्रिएटिंग अ नेगेटिव वाई कंपोनेंट अलोंग विद अ पॉजिटिव
ओके
So there's also a positive x component, of course. That's clear. So actually, AB together, the net field is not negative y. It is having an x component and a negative y component.
Yes.
Okay, na? Similarly, you visualize the triangle CDP, and you will see that together they are creating a negative x component and a negative y component. So the x components cancel out, and we are left with a negative y component.
Okay.
Right. But as you can realize that here there's some three-dimensionality you want. Let's try the other thing. Now, if you draw the triangle ACP again and BPD again like that, so what will happen? One advantage is the two triangles you're talking about, they are lying in mutually perpendicular planes. You know, because AC ka jo diagonal plane hai, involving the x-axis, or the plane of the triangle ACP and the plane of the triangle BPD, they are cutting each other perpendicularly. Right, so visualize this diagram from the top, looking into the x-axis. So you're looking at something like this. This is your y-axis, this is your z-axis. Now what is happening? Your A and C, this is your square now. So the plane which is along the x-axis, including the points A and C, that is this plane, this one. And including the points B and D, that is this one. So they are mutually perpendicular planes. Understanding? So this dotted line, if you just make it a plane coming out of the board, including the x-axis, that is the plane in which the triangle ACP is lying. Okay. And similarly, this is the plane in which the triangle BPD is lying. Okay. So these two triangles are in perpendicular planes. So that helps a little bit. Okay, are you understanding my point?
Yes.
Okay, so next what you can do to help yourself is reorient your axis. Take this as, let's say, the y prime axis and take this as your z prime axis. Take the diagonal axis as your mutually perpendicular axis. That will just make life a little bit easier now. So now what is happening? The triangle ECP that we're going to draw, that is going to lie in which plane? The y prime x one plane. Right, and the other triangle we are going to draw, the one
that
with that is going to, so now you draw your triangle ACP that is in the y prime x plane. So that's a fairly easy thing now. So this is your y prime axis.
Sir, wo field ka jo direction rahega wo negative y prime mein hoga na? Negative y prime.
Yes, that.
Y prime x.
Because here, E is lying over here, and C is lying over here. So this is positive, and this is negative, and P is lying over here. So you can see that the field that they will together create dipole है, so it will create a field in this sort of direction, negative y direction. They create a field like this. So this is the field E1, let us see. So this field E1, now we can easily figure out how much it is, because these distances are r and these angles are theta. So here, which components are adding? The sine components are adding in the field, because this one is creating a field like this and this one is creating a field like this. So the sine theta components are adding. So it is 2 times k q by r square sine theta. So you can see it is E1's magnitude is 2k q by r square into sine theta. Now is this length is how much? This is half the diagonal. So it is E by root 2. So E by root 2 divided by r. So E1's magnitude is, we can write this as root 2 k cube divided by r cube, where r is the same thing. R is square root of x square plus e square by 2. Okay. So this is E1, and in fact we can even write E1 as a vector now. So we can write E1 as a vector as this magnitude. Now see, in my original diagram, what is the direction of y prime? It is between y and z axis. So y prime ka jo unit vector hoga, let's say this unit vector is some n1 cap. So n1 cap kaisa ho jayega? It will be 1 by root 2 k cap, 1 by root 2 j cap. So this is basically n1 cap. So that is equal to root 2 k cube by r cube into 1 by root 2 k cap plus 1 by root 2. So you even got a vector notation in case you need to work that out. But here probably you can just do by adding components and cancelling components. It's like this. So ye E1 ho gaya. And once you figured out E1, the other one is very simple. It's just a, you know, sort of apply a symmetry again. So now we are drawing the same diagram, but in the Z prime X plane. So we are drawing triangle BPD. So here, coming back here, you can see that BPD mein D is on the positive side of the z-axis, P is K, and D is the negatively charged particle. So the negatively charged particle, D is here, and the positively charged particle, D is over here. And again, we have that same triangle. So this time, this is creating a field along which direction? It's creating a field along the positive z-prime direction, which will have the same kind of equation. So this E2 field will have the same magnitude as E1, which was root 2k q divided by r square, divided by r cube into E. In this slide, like this, 2a by r. Now we've accounted for all that sine theta, no? It's just a simple. There's an E here. So that is done, and E2 as a vector now, you can see is this magnitude E2 into, let's say, N2 cap, and N2 cap in my first diagram here is along this direction. So N2 cap kidhar lie kar raha hai? It is lying in my this thing between y and negative y and z. Just moving. So N2 cap kya ho jayega? Between positive z. And so it's minus 1 by root 2 j cap plus 1 by root 2 j cap. So this is my E2 as a vector. E2 is the field because of which one? It's a field because of B plus D. And E1 earlier was a field because of A plus C. And now you just add them. So this is the field because of A plus C. Okay, so I'll just minimize this for you people. And yeah, tell me what is the doubt you have.
Sir,
unit vectors. Okay, I'm coming to that. Unit vector is how that if you have an xy plane like this, a unit vector in this direction, where this angle is theta, will become cos theta I cap plus sin theta. Similarly, a unit vector like this, let's say m cap, where let's say
माइनस के एंड माइनस जे रहेगा और यू टू में माइनस जे एंड प्लस के रहेगा ना सर
इवन में इट इज अलोंग द नेगेटिव वाई एक्सिस अच्छा
यस सर माइनस के एंड माइनस जे एंड फॉर यू टू
या सो इट विल बी पॉजिटिव
के एंड नेगेटिव वाई फॉर ई टू
करेक्ट ओके सो n1 कैप शुड नॉट बी हियर n1 कैप शुड बी हियर सो n1 कैप इज जस्ट नेगेटिव ऑफ व्हाट आई हैव रिटन तो यहाँ पे जो भी लिखा मैंने n1 का है उसका नेगेटिव कर दो सो दिस शुड बी फर्स्ट इज दैट टर्म e ओवर हियर And then this should be minus I cap, minus J cap by root 2.
And minus K cap by root
2. Correct? It's correct now, no?
Yes, sir. And in
right,
U2,
so,
it would
so
be,
cap is
it would be positive K and negative J. Root 2.
It would be along this direction, no? So it's along the direction of z cap, matlab z prime. So z prime is having a positive z and a negative y.
Yes, sir.
Positive z and a negative y. Okay. So now it seems to be prime. And finally, just add these two vectors. E1 and E2. Okay. So just take a look at this and the one below. And meanwhile, I'll switch to the next question. Okay, so shall I move on from this question now? Because I'll be giving you the whiteboard, so complete the final calculation, right?
Sir, I have a doubt.
Ah,
sir, this on adding will get a factor of 2 on the numerator.
So our E net will become how much? E1 plus E2 mein, kaun sa component add ho raha hai?
माइनस जे का कंपोनेंट ऐड होगा के वाला कैंसिल हो जाएगा
तो वी आर हैविंग 2 टाइम्स एंड दिस रूट 2 इज एनीवे कैंसिलिंग आउट
हां रूट 2 इज कैंसिलिंग तो ऊपर में 2 बचा
2 के क्यू ए डिवाइडेड बाय दिस थिंग आर क्यू दैट इज ए स्क्वायर बाय 2 प्लस एक्स स्क्वायर टू द पावर 3 बाय 2 ओके जे कैप माइनस Is this correct?
But in the answer, it's given a factor of 4 in the numerator.
So see, if they've taken LCM here in the denominator and brought that 2 in the numerator. Aisa kiya hai kya? 4 AQE divided by A square plus 2X square. Is it this?
Sir, A square by 2 plus X square raised to 3 by 2 niche mein.
A square by 2 by yahi hai?
Haan.
Okay. So, can just check the calculation at once again. Okay. So in case there's a calculation mistake, we can just check it out. Okay. But by and large, this is what it should be.
Okay. I'll see.
Yeah, I'll share the whiteboard with you guys so you can just check up if there's a calculation mistake in this, you can correct the question. Or I mean you can correct my solution. And if there's my solution is correct, then just make a correction in the question. Okay. Now I'm sharing the next one. Just a second. Okay, I have a bit of a software hang currently again.
Sir, in the next one, eighth question,
just give me. Are you getting the whiteboard still?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so that has got that has got hanged actually. So I'm not able to change the. So just give me a minute, okay? I will. Okay, so this should now work. Hang on a second. That other screen is off the internet, but it's still showing that it's sharing. Finally, I think right. So this eighth question next. Let's go through it.
Okay. So I just wanted to know the answer because my answer is not matching. I'm getting zero.
Okay. So let me go through the question. So figure says that there are three infinite non-conducting plates of charge. Okay. Perpendicular to the plane of the vapor, they're kept like that, plus sigma, plus 2 sigma, and minus sigma. Then find the ratio of the net electric field at the point A and B. Okay. So at the point A, what is happening? The positive on its left is creating sigma by 2 epsilon naught along the positive x-axis.
Yes.
Right. Then we have 2 sigma by 2 epsilon naught towards the negative x-axis.
Negative x-axis.
And again, we have sigma by 2 epsilon naught towards the positive x-axis. Okay? So, the positive charge on the left-hand side and the negative charge on the right-hand side of it together are creating a field which should balance the field because of the middle plate.
Yes.
So at the point A, yes. In fact, the field should be zero. Okay. That's correct.
Then the zero is that.
So the ratio should be zero. Correct? Answer is given something else, is it?
Yes, it's given something else.
Okay. So, just make a correction in the answer key. Okay. Now, next question, which one? This one, right? 14th one?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's go through this. A particle of mass m charge q greater than 0 with initial kinetic energy is projected from infinity towards a heavy nucleus of charge q, assumed to have a fixed position. So, nucleus is fixed and the charge particle is projected from infinity. So, energy will be conserved. I mean, that is electrostatic potential energy plus kinetic energy. And your angular momentum will be conserved, right? About the center of the nucleus.
Okay.
So I'm guessing these two properties have to use. Okay. If the aim is perfect, how close to the center is the particle when it comes instantaneously to rest? So how close will it be to the center if you're giving it a kinetic energy half mv square, which is equal to k small q into capital Q divided by the radius of the nucleus. Okay, then you will be able to come to right to the surface of the nucleus.
Yes.
Sir, can you explain again that in 11th question, how was it 0?
I'll explain. Okay. Just a moment. So let me get the whiteboard. So imagine what is happening, that you have the particle, the charge particle plus Q, okay, right at the center of the nucleus. So at infinity, just a second. So at the center of the nucleus, how much is the, so here you have to assume the nucleus is like, you know, a this thing, like a sphere of non-conducting material having uniform charge density. So remember the formula of potential inside. Inside a sphere, potential kaise nikalte hain? That quadratic formula.
R square minus capital R square.
Yes, correct. You know, and in that formula also, for questions like this, you should remember a shortcut trick, that the potential at the dead center is always 1.5 times the potential at the surface. Correct. So we'll use that trick. So this question is all about potential at a point inside a solid sphere. So let me do a quick reminder of that. So right, so we have this situation that we have a solid sphere with uniform charge density. Okay, so total charge plus Q, but radius R. So it has a uniform charge density rho of Q upon 4/3 pi r cube like this. Okay. Then potential is given by this two-part formula. It is Kq by r for a point which is outside. So r is greater than capital R. Okay. Whereas inside, so unfortunately again my software is stuck. So I'll just describe you the question while, you know, you're working this out, or let me see if I can share on something else. Yeah. So, what is happening? The potential inside is given by this kind of formula. Kq by 2r cube into 3r, sorry, 3 capital R square minus small r square. This kind of formula when r is this thing, very
less than capital.
Less than. So when you see this formula, you can see that potential at the center is actually 3/2 times Kq by R. And the easy way to remember this is that it is actually 1.5 times or 3/2 times the potential at surface. So use this now. Okay. So this formula is clear, right? Okay. So now from this formula, just speaking again. Yeah. So from this formula, you can see that this thing. If your charge particle is aimed from infinity with a speed V or V naught like this plus Q, then to reach the center point, okay, it will have to increase the potential energy of the system by plus K, capital Q, because this capital Q and radius R, into 3/2 R, that is the potential at the center multiplied by charge particle. So ye uska delta U now. So your change in kinetic energy will have to be half mv square minus half mv naught square when it reaches the center. So V is speed at the center. Assuming, of course, there are no mechanical forces involved. So as it's penetrating the nucleus, okay, I'm assuming there's only electrostatic force, nothing else. Okay. So the condition for it to reach the center is that V should be greater than or equal to 0. So basically, delta U plus delta KE should be greater than or equal to 0. legs. So this is zero, but in this we are getting the condition that v is greater than or equal to zero. So from that we'll get the condition that half m v naught square should be greater than or equal to this thing, v by 2 a capital Q into small q divided by r. Right, Alman, this will give you the answer, I think.
Yes.
Okay. So in general, before you know, you just write down this thing. You would always remember this as a graph also. The relation between potential and distance from the center. So that graph is like this. If this is the surface point, so this is the potential at the surface. So outside it is hyperbolic, inside it is like this, parabolic. And the potential at the center is like that. It is 3 by 2 times the potential at the surface.
So the kinetic energy difference is the final minus initial,
yeah? Yes. So delta Ke plus delta U is zero. Your potential energy is increasing. All right. So if your potential energy is increasing, your kinetic energy has to decrease. So now the change in kinetic energy is half mv square minus half mv naught square. Assuming that, you know, at the center, this is what is happening. Okay. So half m v square minus v naught square, okay, plus this thing 3 by 2 kq into small q divided by r is equal to 0. This is a given because your total change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy should be 0. That is a known quantity. But in this, we have to now put the condition for v to be greater than or equal to 0. It should just about reach the center. So that means v should not become greater than, should not become 0 before it reaches the center. So that's the condition. So put the condition that V is greater than or equal to 0, you'll get the condition on V naught, which I had written earlier. TK, clear?
Yes, sir.
Pritika, is that clear to you also?
What if the velocity is negative?
Nahi ho sakta na, that is the thing. Kinetic energy can't be negative, no? So that means it has stopped before reaching the center.
Velocity square will be positive, but I was talking...
See, here we are doing a work energy equation. So it is not about direction of velocity. It is about the kinetic energy or the speed.
Okay.
So the speed or the kinetic energy, either of them cannot become negative at this center. That is the point. And direction here we are sure about, no? Because we are doing a one-dimensional motion. We've aimed it at the center.
Okay.
No, so the acceleration vector and the velocity vector are always opposite to each other. Till it stops and then they become same in direction. So it's a 1D motion. So there's no problem about direction. Okay. The only thing is whether it will stop at the center or before it reaches the center, or it will just go past the center. So here, for example, if your final V is coming greater than 0 in this equation, then it actually goes past the center and comes out from the other side. But if in this equation you adjusted the value of V naught such that your V square is coming as a negative quantity, that means it never reaches the center. It stops before reaching the center. That is the point.
Okay.
Understood? Oh. Alright, so let me now get to the next question. Right, so let's pick up this question now, 27th one.
So the fourth part.
Okay. So what is happening? Find out the force experienced by a short dipole P naught is following four different arrangements in the given figure. Okay. So there are two dipoles. So the force experience when they are perpendicular to each other, like this. And we have to assume probably R is large compared to. Is that given to us or? Okay, so we can assume that also. So we can see here that what we can do is we can use a bit of small angle approximation. Because if you assume that if you break your dipole P naught and one into two charges, the positive charge and the negative charge, now you can see that the positive charge is sitting at a slight angle above the equatorial line. And the negative charge is sitting at a slight angle below the equatorial line with respect to the P. Right? So we have got some kind of a formula for the radial component and the tangential component of electric field. So what is happening is, you know, if you were right on the equatorial line, that is, if you're sitting right on the dotted line, which is in the diagram, then what is happening? Your tangential component of electric field is becoming zero. You are having only a radial component.
Yes.
Okay. But if you are slightly above that, then there is some tangential component, slight amount. And if you're slightly below that, there's some slight amount of tangential component. So that tangential component will more or less be same at theta above and theta below, as long as theta is small. But above, we have a positive charge sitting, and below, we have a negative charge sitting. So the forces will become in the same direction. Okay. So, you know, relate this with the general, this thing, the general radial and component, radial and tangential component of electric field at a general angle theta for the dipole P. And then make that theta almost tend to 180, but in one case slightly less than 180, one case slightly greater than 180, and apply the small angle approximation. So I think that is how you can proceed with this. So I'm just illustrating what I'm saying here. So once again, regardless of, I just hope that my whiteboard doesn't hang again. I'm happening a bit today. So anyway, so let us say that these are my axes. So first let us concentrate on that if I have this dipole over here, so I have this dipole P over here, okay. Then from it at a general position, R like this. General position R vector like this, what will be the components of field? So there will be a radial component of field like this, and there should be a tangential component of field like this. Because remember, with respect to my proper sense, this is theta. So the tangential direction is this one, it's not the other one, it's not this direction, it's this one. So what I'm saying next is, now your theta, you write it as actually 180 minus some small angle, like phi or something, or 180 minus delta theta, and you write the expression for tangential and radial component over there. Similarly, next you take the point which is below this one, where your negative charge of that P naught is sitting. So there your theta will actually be greater than 180, but by a small amount delta theta.
Okay.
Are you getting my point? So
yes.
Now you make your two charges, your plus Q naught and your minus Q naught sit at those two kind of points, and you should be able to figure out the answer. Just try this, what I'm saying. Okay, you should be able to work
this.
So I'll put up the solution. Just try it by that method.
Sir, मुझे समझा नहीं.
So what will be the direction of the force? Net direction?
सर आप एक और बार एक्सप्लेन कीजिए ना, मुझे समझा नहीं तो.
या सो आई एम कमिंग बैक टू दिस. ओके सो अभी देखो क्या हो रहा है यहाँ पे. व्हाट इज द रेडियल कंपोनेंट ऑफ फील्ड गिवन बाय, इट इज 2 केपी
बाय आर क्यू
बाय क्यू है ना, एंड योर केपी कॉस थीटा बाय आर क्यू, एंड योर टेंजेंशियल कंपोनेंट ऑफ फील्ड इज गिवन बाय केपी साइन थीटा बाय आर क्यू. नाउ बेसिकली सी यूजिंग दिस फॉर्मूला I want to find the field, so-called, at these two points. Let's say this point is point A, and then again at this point, point B. So at the point A, not working out today. Just hang on a second. Okay, so at the point B, what you do in this formula only now is that you replace theta with what, 180 minus delta theta.
Yes.
Understanding my point. And at the point B, you replace theta with 180 plus delta theta, pi plus delta theta, but delta theta tending to zero. So you will get some fields, right? And then at the point A, you place your plus Q naught charge, and at the point B, you place your minus Q naught charge. Just that. Okay. So at A, you place your theta as limit delta theta tending to zero, pi minus theta. Pi minus delta theta, and at B you place theta as limit delta theta tending to zero pi plus delta theta. Okay, so what will happen is at A,
sir, which angle is delta theta?
Delta theta therefore is this one, no, because you see I have written theta as pi minus delta theta for the point A, no? And pi plus delta theta for the point B, right, no? So the point A is somewhere here, no? तो ये वाले एंगल को मैंने थीटा लिखा है और थीटा को मैं पाई माइनस डेल्टा थीटा लिखा है ना, सो डेल्टा थीटा इज दैट स्मॉल एंगल ओवर दिस वन, दैट्स नो, बिकॉज़ यू आर अल्टीमेटली गोइंग टू प्लेस योर डाइपोल ना ओवर हियर, गोइंग टू प्लेस योर स्मॉल डाइपोल पी नॉट ओवर हियर, सो इनफैक्ट योर डेल्टा थीटा विल बिकम हाफ द लेंथ ऑफ द डाइपोल डिवाइडेड बाय आर, बिकॉज़ योर आर इज गोइंग टू कम टू दिस वन, दिस वन, यू अंडरस्टैंड. So if this dipole has a length of, you know, so suppose the second dipole is like this, it is 2 Q naught L naught, then your delta theta will approximately be L naught by R, right, which is a very small angle. Okay. So again, at A, what is happening? Your radial component of field at A will be in which direction? The negative X direction. So if you write radial component as a vector quantity, it will be, now see, you substitute this, so this is almost pi, na? So cos pi is how much? Minus 1. So that is why it's along the negative direction. So it is almost approximately equal to minus
2kp by r cube,
you know, I cap. Whereas your tangential component is the one which is almost negligible, but here we won't be able to detect it because we are sitting with two different. Na? So is point ke liye tangential component downwards and how much it is? It is KP, not 2KP. So KP sine theta, and sine theta will tend to become sine delta theta, and delta theta is very small. Now, so it is approximately KP delta theta, because it's a very small angle. You know? So sine theta, which is sine of pi minus delta theta, is becoming sine delta theta. And because delta theta is small, so that's approximately equal to delta. So this upon R cube minus j cap. Okay. Whereas this is at A. Whereas at B, you'll see your radial component is the same, but your tangential component ulta ho gaya direction. It will be along plus j cap. Because sine of pi plus delta theta is how much? Minus sine delta theta, no?
Yeah.
It will be positive in the first case, not tangential.
See, it is positive in theta cap. Your ET, matlab your tangential component is like this. Your electric field is ER r cap plus E tangential theta cap. Now, what is your tangential unit vector here? That itself is minus j cap. Are you understanding my point? So, jahan pe ET positive aata hai, actually, wahan pe direction minus j cap ke along. because it will be along the tangential unit vector, and the tangential unit vector.
Okay.
This you have to be very careful about this. You can also figure this out by, you know, just by hand by taking positive and negative charge, so you realize, nice, like this. But so that's why this diagram is also showing you, know, this one is having a this component, whereas if you take a point like this below it, it will be symmetrical, no? So at the point below it, the symmetry will show that, at a point like this, the symmetry will show that the radial component is like this, but the tangential component is like this.
Yes, sir.
It's not like that. That is why. So that's why your radial component as a vector quantity is now again minus 2kp by rq I cap, but your tangential component is equal and opposite. It is kp delta theta by r cube j cap. So now, interestingly, what is happening? At B, you have a negative charge sitting, and at A, you have a positive charge sitting. Okay, so therefore, the net force that acts on that dipole will be plus Q naught into the field at the point A, minus Q naught into the field at the point B. And the field at the point A is basically the sum of these two, and the field at the point B is the sum of these two. So you have, you know, EA minus EB. So EA minus EB means the radial component is cancelling. You're left with just the tangential component. So it is 2 times KP delta theta by R cube minus J across. And then you substitute now over here. Okay. So your delta theta, remember, was how much? It was your this thing, L naught by R. Where L naught is half the length of that other dipole. Okay. So like this. Okay. And then again, you substitute Q naught into 2 L naught over here as basically what? P naught. So it will become K P P naught, okay, divided by R to the power 4, and the direction is minus J cap. Is it clear, Arman?
Yes.
All right, so shall we move on to this question? We can complete this?
Yes.
Okay. The other parts of this question 27 are clear, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now this one, right?
12 one? Yes. I got this.
So let's move on to something else. What about this 21st
yes,
one?
This one, oh. I did not.
Okay. So electric potential decreases uniformly from V to minus V. From this equation. So what we have to do, we have to find the formula of potential, you know, in terms of x, and then use gradient. Are you following my point, Arman?
Yes. Yeah. So can you repeat? I actually, the connection was.
Okay. So see, kya ho raha hai? My potential is changing from plus V to minus V, okay?
Yes.
From the x coordinate of minus x to plus x, but at a uniform rate.
Yes.
Right, so if I draw my graph of potential versus x, it's a straight line, na? So it's a straight line having what kind of slope? It's a straight line having negative slope. Because as you're going from minus x to plus x, your potential is going from plus V to minus V. No, so it's like a diagonal line going through the origin, but of negative slope like that.
Yes.
Okay. So slope kitna ho jayega? Minus of V by X, minus of V by X naught. So electric field kya hoga? Negative of the slope.
V naught by X. Plus
V by X naught.
Yes.
Yeah. Understood, Kritika? You are also clear about this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So see what is happening here in this diagram. I mean, in this question, if we just follow the data of the question and think of now plotting potential versus x. So what it's saying that your potential is changing from some plus v to minus v as your x coordinate is changing from minus x naught to plus x naught. So that means your graph of potential is actually like this. Your graph of potential is a straight line going through this. It's changing from this data point here.
It is going from positive to negative x or negative to positive x?
So the question was saying that your potential changes from plus v to minus v as your coordinate changes from minus x to plus
x. Okay. So it will be negative slope then.
So now you can see the slope of this line is minus v by x naught.
Yes.
So now you use your formula that electric field is
v by x
naught. It's negative gradient of potential. So, so it's a one-dimensional situation here. So
it will be v by x naught.
Yes. Done?
Yes.
Okay. So, both of you are clear. We'll move on to the next question.
But the option given is maybe V by X naught.
Okay.
B option is given as correct.
Okay. Let me just share that again.
What is the option given?
Yeah, I'm just bringing up the question. Yeah. So, the question has the options. Okay. Now see, now the question is saying very clearly that potential decreases uniformly from V to minus V along the x-axis as the coordinate changes like this. Okay. Then the electric field at the origin is how much? Okay. Now see, one thing is there. The question is not giving you any information about rate of change with Y and Z.
Yes.
You understanding my point, no? It is just giving me the information that I strictly x-axis ke along move kar raha hun, toh mera electric field aisa change ho raha hai. So what it is actually giving me is del V by del X. And that too along the x-axis. But I have no information about del V by del Y or del V by del Z. Right? Isn't that point clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Because the data in the question is simply not telling you that if you move along your y-axis or your direction of motion changes from the strictly x-axis, from minus x-naught to plus x-naught, if something else is changing, so I don't know what is happening about the potential. So I don't know whether del V by del Y is there or not, del V by del Z is there or not.
Sir, matlab y or z-axis se bhi thoda bahut contribution ho sakta hai.
हो सकता है ना, दैट इज द पॉइंट.
ओके,
इट इज जस्ट गिविंग यू टू डेटा पॉइंट्स दैट इफ यू मूव फ्रॉम माइनस एक्स नॉट टू प्लस एक्स नॉट स्टिकिंग द एक्स एक्सिस, यू आर नेवर मूविंग अवे फ्रॉम द एक्स, इन दैट केस योर पोटेंशियल इज चेंजिंग लाइक दिस, बट इट्स नॉट टेलिंग यू दैट इफ यू वेंट ऑन सम कर्व्ड पाथ फ्रॉम माइनस एक्स नॉट टू प्लस एक्स नॉट ऑन द एक्स एक्सिस हाउ द पोटेंशियल चेंजिंग, नॉट टेलिंग यू दैट. सो दैट मींस वी हैव नो इन्फॉर्मेशन इन द क्वेश्चन अबाउट the variation of potential with y or z coordinate. So that means we have no information about EY and EZ. We have only information about the x component of electric field.
Okay.
Okay. So minimum magnitude of electric field kitna ho sakta hai? V by x naught. That is if your EY and EZ is zero. But maximum we can't say. It can be greater than that also. So we can't say that it must be greater. Okay. We can't say it is must be equal to. And definitely we can say it is not going to be less than. So D is ruled out. So the only option which is correct that it may be equal to V by X naught. On the other hand, another option had been that it may be greater than V by X naught. That would have also been correct. Right. So this question is fully clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. What about this one? This is something we have to discuss, Arman?
No, sir. This was done. This was done.
Oh, this was done. Okay.
Fine, this was done.
Anything else from what you have sent me?
Yes, sir. The last. Yes, these two.
This looks like a good question, but let me try to get the orientation correct here. So the figure shows a non-conducting ring, which has positive and negative charge non-uniformly distributed such that the total charge is zero. Which of the following is true? The potential at all points on the axis will be zero. Definitely, that is true. See, on the axis of the ring, if you take any arbitrary dq on one side, there's a arbitrary minus dq at a symmetrical point on the other side and they are equidistant.
Yes.
Matlab just visualize this problem like this now. Okay, that let's say the axis is your x axis. Okay, so the ring is lying in the yz plane. Okay. Now, if the diameter which is separating the negative and positive charge, that diameter is suppose your z axis. Okay. So yz plane mein z axis ek plus theta pe lo aur ek minus theta pe lo. So they are equal and opposite charges.
Yes.
And they will be equidistant from your point on the axis. So the contribution to potential will cancel each other. So that is why just by looking at the symmetry itself, you know. So take that vertical diagonal that you can see in the diagram, the one which is separating the negative and positive charge, let's say as your z-axis, and take the axis which they pointed as your x-axis. So at any point on the x-axis, you look at a charge which is at positive theta from your z-axis and at minus theta from your z-axis, you will see that their potentials will cancel.
Sir, A option
right. So the potential at all points on the axis will be zero.
Yes,
that
sir.
Is in fact correct.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that also means that your del V by del R along that axis is zero. That means that at any point on the axis, there's no electric field pointing along the axis. In fact, you'll realize the electric field will be pointing along the negative Y axis. If I've taken the vertical axis as a Z axis, the electric field will be pointing along a negative Y axis. Positive charge ka repulsion and negative charge ka attraction. Okay, so electric field at all points on the axis will not be zero. The direction of electric field at all points will be along the axis is also wrong. So
sir,
option A is come to option B. If the ring is placed,
sir,
whiteboard
ke
batane mujhe.
Sir,
yeah, sorry, which one? Option C. Come again, beta. I'm not able to hear you. The direction of the field you are talking about?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let me work this out. Okay. So now, as far as the direction is concerned, now see, let me assume that I am looking at the ring from the top. So my axis, which is there in the diagram, that is actually coming out of the plane. Just a moment. Okay. So in my diagram now, this vertical axis is my so-called y-axis, and this horizontal axis is my z-axis, let's say. That's what we're originally talking about. And the symmetry axis is the one which is coming out of the plane. So y-axis will be like this, or y-axis will be like this. The y-axis will be like this. So anyway, it doesn't matter. X-axis is coming out of the plane, so. Anyway, it doesn't matter. So this side is having negative charge, isn't it? Yeah, I think this side was having negative charge. This side was having positive charge. So this is the two-dimensional version of this diagram. This side was having positive charge. So I have labeled this as my z-axis, this as my y-axis, and this is the x-axis. And I'm looking at a point like this on the x-axis. Okay, so at a point like this, now you can see that a particle like this will create a field which has a component along the positive x-axis plus the component opposite to it. And another point just hang on a second. Okay, people just have to take. Okay, so people just work on this question for a moment. I have to reboot the whole system again. Just take a 1 minute break. Okay, we'll start again. Okay, so coming back to that question, so we were looking at the ring from front. Okay, what we said is that from front, if all right, so this was my y-axis, this was my z-axis. And we had positive charge here. And we had negative charge on the other side here. Okay. Now see, visualize any point which is lying in front of the origin over here on the z-axis. So I'm not looking at the origin at this point. I'm actually looking at a point in front of the origin, you know, pointing towards you. So the positive charge there will create what kind of a field? It will create a kind of field which has some component along the positive x-axis. So the positive charge will create some field which will have some component along the positive x-axis plus a component along the y-axis. Are you understanding my point? Symmetry, that's why it will be along the y-axis. So the positive charge will create some field which will have some x component along plus I cap and some y component along positive y cap. So this component of field it will create will be like this, the positive charge. This is all. Whereas there will be another component which is coming out of the plane. So I'll just show that with a dot. Whereas the negative charge on the other hand, it will create what kind of a field? It will create some field which is having a direction going towards of. So it will have a negative x component, but again a positive y component. So the negative charge will create a field जिसका y component ऐसा होगा, but दूसरा वाला component ऐसा होगा. So the x components are cancelling each other and the y component is remaining. So the net field at any point on the x-axis will actually point like that. It will point parallel to that other diameter, the diameter which is actually bisecting the positive and negative charge. So that is how it will look. So in 3D, it looks something like this. That you know, if this is your ring and this is the one which is dividing the charge.
Z-axis.
Or ESI. So the positive charge is on this side. And the negative charge is on that side. Okay. Now you consider any point on this symmetry axis at a point like this. So you can see the negative charge is creating one component of field towards the origin, which is getting cancelled by the component that the positive charge is creating away from the origin. But both the positive and negative charge are creating some field which is parallel to your y-axis like this.
Yes.
So at different points, the field will be like this. So the field will again be such that actually it has a maxima somewhere in between. At the origin, the field will be maximum. So at the original, you will have the longest value of this, and this will be decreasing as you go along. So electric field lines at different points, or the electric field vectors, will be such that the magnitude is decreasing, but their direction is always parallel to the y-axis at any point on the x-axis. Right, Arman? So this is clear, I hope.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good.
Sir, what are the options?
Let me unshare this and come back to the options. Right, so these were the options. Now you see which option will fit.
A is correct.
A is correct. B is wrong. C is also wrong. What is D saying? If you place it in a uniform electric field, then the net torque and force acting on the ring would be zero. No, the ring will act like a dipole. So in a uniform electric field, the net force will be zero, but the net torque will be zero only in a certain condition, that P cross E is equal to zero.
Okay.
Right? So only option A should be correct according to me, okay?
Yes.
Okay. Then next, this question, Arman?
Yes, it's 17.
Okay, so let's take a look at this. So simple pendulum of length L and mass M, and the bob is having a charge plus Q, whereas there's a surface which is perpendicular to the plane of the diagram like this, is sigma. Find the maximum angle through which the string is deflected from the vertical. So see, it is initially in the vertical position, because only mg is acting on it, and then you bring the wall of charge next to it. So there is a horizontal electric field that starts acting on it. Okay. So what happens? That electrostatic force creates a torque, or creates a tangential force, or whatever you can say. So that starts moving it. Now you have to find out what is the maximum angular displacement to which it will go. So what concept you should use for maximum angular displacement? Arman, what did you try in the question?
I got tan theta is equal to QE upon mg, and I put the values, and then I got theta.
You got tan theta QE by mg is by equilibrium, na beta?
Yes, sir. Tan theta goes.
At which there is equilibrium. The tension is the vector sum. But see, here what is happening, it's an oscillation. It will go into oscillation because it's starting from rest at one extreme position.
Okay, so it will be 2 into that theta.
Okay, so that diagonal line that you drawn at theta equal to tan inverse of electrostatic force by mg, that diagonal line is now your equilibrium line. And it's starting from one extreme, let's say at minus theta, and it's going to the other extreme at plus theta. So you can think of this question like an equivalent gravity question. If you take this vector sum of electrostatic force and mg as the equivalent weight of the particle, because it's a charged particle in an electric field. So the equivalent weight is acting along a diagonal line like this. Right? So that concept. So Kritika, have you understood the question? Let me just figure this out for you people. Yeah, so this is the thing. In any situation like this, the easiest and the fastest way to go about it is by using that effective gravity concept or effective weight kind of concept. So you have a bob sitting here, and you have positive charge sigma on this side. So that is creating electrostatic force like this on it. And it is creating, and of course the gravity is creating gravitational force downwards. So what you can do here is very conveniently, you can take the vector sum of these two to be like your effective weight. You can think of this like a F effective, other than the tension, of course. Okay? So you can see that this angle, obviously, that angle theta is tan inverse of electrostatic force divided by mg. So that is tan inverse of q into sigma by 2 epsilon naught divided by mg. Okay. So when this is in this kind of situation, now where the string is actually along that line, that is when it will be in equilibrium. So when it's here, such that the string is along that effective force.
Tension
is that time just tension minus effective force will provide the centripetal force. But see, you started from here at t equal to 0 at rest. So by the time you reached here, it'll have the maximum speed. So it'll cross this point and it'll go to the other side to the same theta. And again, it'll come to rest here. No, and it'll keep oscillating back and forth between these two. This is what will happen. So that is why the maximum angular displacement will be twice of theta. So it will be 2 times tan inverse F divided by mg, electrostatic force by mg, right?
Okay.
So that's a little trick that you can use in these problems. Hope this is clear, Vita?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So let me then come to the next question.
Okay.
We missed something in between.
Yeah.
This
song. I got
done. 25th Arman is done, no?
Which one, sir? Yes, 25th is done. Yes, sir, that was the last doubt which I had. The pendulum.
That was the last doubt. Okay. Okay, so you people have some few minutes free for you?
Yes.
You want to discuss some additional questions which I can give you?
Okay.
It's up to you guys. If you have other studies to do, it's fine. You can drop me your doubts later. But if you just want to discuss some general questions, I can put up some questions for you.
Sir, you were explaining me that 11th question once again.
Which one, Vidai?
That electric field at 2 points A and B, and there were 3 infinite long lines. First 2 were positive and last 1 was negative.
Achha, the line of charge potential difference, that one?
Yes, sir. Whatever.
The lines of charge and so see, for that, the effective way of doing a question like that is, you know, just remember that if you have an infinite line of charge, okay, then you can calculate the potential difference between any 2 points. You cannot calculate the absolute potential, but you can calculate the potential difference between any 2 points because you know that your equipotential surfaces are cylinders. Okay. So if you have one cylinder of radius A and you consider another cylinder now, concentric around that, or coaxial around that rather, of radius B. Okay. So this one has a radius B now. So you consider any point on cylinder A and any point on cylinder B. It could even be one point A is over here and the other point is over here. It doesn't matter. The potential difference between them comes from this thing. It comes from integration of lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught r dr with a negative sign from r equal to b to r equal to b. So that potential difference comes as that logarithmic term. So this is the basic thing to remember. So it is lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught ln of b by a. And you can see this has to be a positive quantity because it's a positively charged particle and you're going away from the Va minus Vb. That means you're coming closer. So your potential has to increase. Va has to be greater than Vb. So this formula is clear, Kritika, how we got this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now see, in that case, what we had to do is we had 3 rods. Okay.
Question mein
potential difference between 2 points pucha tha.
So
one rod was, let's say, along the y-axis. Another rod was, let's say, like this, along the x-axis. Were there any rods involved in today's questions? Okay, let me just check. Okay, so in the meantime, Arman, are you there? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Let me just give you guys a good question that I just came across a couple of days back. So we'll discuss that. You can try that question and I'll explain, Kritika, your 11th question to you also. So, this is the question. Okay. There is a charged particle plus Q and mass M, okay, that is dropped from height H above the ground. So this is the ground level. Okay. In a region where, in addition to gravity, which is acting vertically downwards, there is also a uniform magnetic field, which is horizontal, and it's like this. So everywhere there is a horizontal magnetic field, uniform horizontal magnetic field, which acts like this. And the charged particle is dropped from rest, from the height H above. So if we take this as our XY axis, so you can see that there is a uniform magnetic field going into the plane. So it is some minus B naught K cap. And of course, gravity is acting. So G is minus G J cap. And this particle is dropped from rest, from rest at this. Okay. So we have to find minimum height so that it does not hit the ground. and assuming if the actual height is greater than this minimum height that you've calculated in the first part, then fine. Velocity and acceleration at the instant when you are downward displacement that is minus y is such that magnitude of that y is maximum. So at the point when it comes lowest, basically, that's what the question is saying. Maximum downward displacement wale point pe, you have to find out what the velocity and acceleration are. Okay. So everything you find out in terms of the given quantities, which are charge of the particle, mass of the particle, acceleration due to gravity, and v naught, the uniform field. So you'll find in terms of this, but you'll see that some parts might be easier than this, might come in less number of terms anymore. Okay. So you're just dropping that particle from that height above the ground, and it's a charged particle that exists in a uniform horizontal magnetic field. So it's not only gravity, but eventually magnetic force also starts acting on it. So it can turn out that it will not hit the ground. But you have to give it a minimum height in order to achieve that condition that is, you know, curving enough in its motion so that it will not hit the ground. So this is one of the questions I wanted to discuss today with you. So try this out and I'll check out the 11th question critical you're talking about. Yeah, Kritika, you meant those four charged particles, that 11th question.
Yes, sir.
So, usme which part you have a doubt in telling
me? The 11th question means there were three long infinite wires. First two were of positive charge and the last was negative charge. And between those three, there were two points A and B. So what was that question?
Any rods nahi the beta, and that was the 8th question, and there were sheets of charge. Okay.
Yes, sir. So this
was an infinite sheet coming out of the plane of the board like this. It's positive, but this was plus sigma.
Yes. Okay.
And then you had plus 2 sigma in this one. These were infinite non-conducting sheets, and you had minus sigma here. Okay. So let's say these are sheets A, B, and C. Now, we are talking about field at a point like this. Now, at a point like this, A will create a field like this, away from itself. B will create a field like this, away from itself. And C will create a field towards itself, because it's negatively charged. Okay. And the magnitude of A's field will be sigma by 2 epsilon naught. The magnitude of C's field will also be sigma by 2 epsilon naught. But B's field will be double, because the sigma is double. So, that's why they were cancelling. So, the field at that point was becoming zero. Is it clear, beta? Okay, just try out this question, the one I've given you now. Okay, so I think you will be aware that in general, what type of motion is happening over here? You have perpendicular gravitational and magnetic fields, right? G and B are perpendicular to each other, and you're releasing a particle from rest. So what is the type of motion that will happen? It's first of all going to be a two-dimensional motion in your diagram in the xy plane, and you'll realize it is what we call a cycloidal motion. It's exactly the same as the case of perpendicular electric and magnetic field. Like when you would have done magnetism, you would have seen the various cases of combination of electric and magnetic fields. So in that you would have seen that whenever electric and magnetic field are perpendicular to each other and uniform, then it creates a cycloidal kind of motion. So this is the same as that, because whatever role the electric field had there, here the gravitational field has the same role. It's creating a uniform amount of force. Okay, so based on that, just try this out.
Sir, usme, since jo beech wala,
which question? The charge sheets one.
Okay, sir.
What is it? Beech wala is creating a field away from itself. No? That's why in my diagram EB is towards the left.
Yes, got it.
Okay. Whereas if you take a point between B and C is the other way. Both EA and EB will be towards the right, and EC will also be towards the right. So they will
all have. Got it.
Yeah, so Arman and Kritika, anything in this question that you've worked out?
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah, tell me.
Why will, what sort of motion can you please explain again?
Okay, so let's go over the whole basics of this. Do you remember having done in class ever this concept of perpendicular electric and magnetic field, kaisa motion hota?
Cycloid.
So let's do a quick revision of that, no problem, because it's one of the tricky things. Then you apply that concept over here. Okay, so let me remind you of that case. Okay. So suppose we have this situation. We have in the xy plane.
So it will perform motion like that of a rectangular hyperbola, something like that.
It will perform what is called cycloidal motion. And the best way to understand cycloidal motion is very interestingly if you see it in mechanics. A particle on the rim of a rolling object. Wo jaisa move karta na aisa, this kind of motion. Just follow my cursor. This type of motion. But I mean this is in the case which I'm showing you. Whereas in this case where the gravity is pointing downwards, if the height is finite, it would be something like this. And then down like that. So the name given specifically to it is cycloidal motion. So let's take a case where this is what is happening. My electric field is, let us say, E naught J tan uniform, and magnetic field, let us say, is B naught K tan.
If the motion is cycloid, which is going downwards, then why will it not touch the ground?
So that's what I'm explaining over here. You'll understand through this, okay? So in my diagram over here, B coming out of the plane. So I have a uniform magnetic field like this.
After question, my electric field mentioned nahi tha.
Sorry? Haan, toh bhi, electric field ka role gravity karega. So I'll explain it to you. Okay? इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड क्रिएट्स अ यूनिफॉर्म फोर्स ना व्हिच इज अपवर्ड्स लाइक दैट ग्रेविटी क्रिएट्स अ यूनिफॉर्म फोर्स व्हिच इज डाउनवर्ड्स इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड इज नॉट इलेक्ट्रिक फोर्स इज नॉट अफेक्टेड बाय मोशन सो लाइक दैट ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स इज नॉट अफेक्टेड बाय मोशन सो यू कुड रिप्लेस दिस इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड विद अ ग्रेविटेशनल फील्ड एज लॉन्ग एज इट्स यूनिफॉर्म एंड इट्स परपेंडिकुलर टू द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड दे विल बोथ रिजल्ट इन द सेम थिंग यू अंडरस्टैंडिंग माय पॉइंट यस So I have magnetic field like this and electric field which is like this, which is pointing upwards. And I'm not going to draw it everywhere, but you understand. This is your electric field and this is your magnetic field. Okay. Now in this situation, I have released my particle from rest, let's say from here. So what will happen? Plus Q and mass M, T equal to zero, the particle is at rest. So at T equal to zero, only electrostatic force will act on it. The force acting on Q E naught. So it will have an upward acceleration like this, which will be equal to Q E naught by M J. Now the moment it develops some momentum in the upward direction, its magnetic force ka direction kya hoga? Do your V cross B. You see it's towards the right. So it starts turning towards the right. So as it starts turning towards the right, your magnetic force always remains in which plane? In the XY plane. Because the magnetic field is along the Z axis.
Yes, sir.
Electrostatic force is always along the Y axis. So there is no component of force along the Z axis. There's only magnetic force which is acting somewhere in the XY plane. And electrostatic force which is always acting in this. So at some point of time when it's over here, the force picture is like this. The electrostatic force is acting like this. And if the velocity of the particle at that moment is something like this, the instantaneous velocity, it has turned to this kind of direction, then the magnetic force acting on it will be in this sort of direction, perpendicular. So these are the combination of forces which are acting. This angle is 90 degrees. It's going in this kind of a path. So the motion is two-dimensional, it's restricted to two-dimensional, you can see. Okay. Now the next thing we do is analyze the motion. So let us say that at some time t,
सर वो एट सम टाइम टी जब भी अगर वो हाईएस्ट पॉइंट पे पहुंचेगा तो वहां पे इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड का जो फोर्स है और जो मैग्नेटिक फील्ड का फोर्स है एग्जैक्टली ऑपोजिट डायरेक्शन में होगा ना
नहीं इन फैक्ट व्हाट वी विल सी इज दैट द मैग्नेटिक फोर्स विल बी डबल ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड एंड दिस इज द रीजन
व्हाई सर मैग्नीट्यूड नहीं जस्ट डायरेक्शन
The magnetic force at the highest point will be double of the electrostatic force and the direction will be opposite. Yes.
Yes. Direction will be
opposite. So that is one thing we will use to solve. Okay. So yeah. So I'm taking the V as two components, Vx I cap plus Vy j cap. So from this you can see that the net force acting on the particle, which is mass into acceleration, will become Q E naught j cap. Plus Q into V cross B, where your V is this and your B was V naught K cap. So now when you just analyze this thing, you will see that your mass into acceleration, which is the net force, will become Q E naught. Okay. Or yahan pe component aa jayega. So I cross K is minus J. So this is minus Vx V naught. This is your this thing component. Which one? Your J cap component. And your V also has a J component, projection. So J cross K is plus I. So that is plus Q V naught Vy I cap. So this is your this equation, force equation, net force. So from this you get that system of what we call coupled differential equation. That acceleration x component depends on Vy and acceleration y component depends on Vx. So you can see from here that Ax is a component of acceleration which is this one divided by mass. So it is Q V naught by M into Vy. And your Ey is this divided by mass. So Q by M into E naught minus V naught Vx. So this is called a coupled differential equation because the rate of change of one thing depends on the other. and the rate of change of the other thing depends on the one. So it is qv naught by m vy, and only there should be some minus sign involved because the y component and the x component is positive. So dvy by dt is equal to q by m v naught minus v naught x. So this system is called the coupled differential equation, equation 1 and equation 2. And what is the general method of solving it? You differentiate it again.
Second
one will differentiate. So you will get that thing. So differentiate the second one again. So you will get d2vy by dt square is minus of qv naught by m into dvx by dt. And then substitute the first equation here. So you will get that second derivative of vy is equal to minus omega square vy, where your omega is qv naught by n. So you get this. Okay. Now from this you can solve it. So we know that vy will be equal to some some, you know, you can say amplitude kind of term.
So remember it's a double derivative ko le rahe the velocity ka.
Kyun liye? Because there was no other way to solve it. See, come back to equation 1 and 2, the coupled differential equation. Derivative of vx is depending on vy, and derivative of vy is depending on vx. So there's no way to solve the differential equation. No? Okay. But what you notice is that if I differentiate the second equation, then I have derivative of vx, and that is in terms of vy. So you get a relation second day. So that's the trick of solving the coupled differential equation. For doing that, you get this. Okay. So and doing this, you know that this is that SHM kind of thing. So it is some amplitude, but just remember that this is velocity amplitude. So it has dimension of velocity into sine of omega t plus some kind of phase constant. So the phase constant and a naught are unknown. So now you notice that at t equal to 0, what was your vy? It was 0. So that means your sine phi should be 0.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And what was your ay? Your ay was actually plus qe naught by m. So that means your a omega cos phi should be plus qe naught by m. Okay. So you can see by comparing this equation and this equation now, first of all, your cos is positive and sine is 0. So phi must be 0. So substitute phi as 0 here. So a omega is this much. And omega you already know. So from this you will get that e omega is q e naught by n. And omega was q b naught by m. So you get that velocity amplitude as e naught by b naught, which you always know has the dimension of velocity. So this is your velocity amplitude. So now you know that, okay, your vy is e sine omega t, because where your e is e naught by b naught, and your this thing omega is q b naught by m. So all these things are known. Okay. Now you come to the other equation, that what was the relation between vx and vy, that differential equation, to go back to. That was the first differential equation, that dvx by dt was omega into vy. So you have dvx by dt was equal to qv naught by m into vy. So that is now telling you that rate of change of vx is equal to, this is the same as omega, and this is the same as e sine omega t. So now you integrate this relation and you're getting vx as a function of time. So dvx starting from 0 initially to some vx, and on the other hand, e omega into sine omega t dt integrated from time 0 to t. So this is that minus cos omega t and all that, you put the limits. So you'll see that you'll get vx as e into 1 minus cos omega t. Because remember that cos 0 is not 0, it is 1. So there is this extra term. So it's not exactly an SHM. Your Vx is like this, your Vy is like this. A sine omega t. So your Vy is varying between plus and minus A. So your Y component of displacement is restricted. Okay. But your X component of displacement is unrestricted. You understand this. But from this point onwards, once you have understood this, that you know the velocity is like this, you don't need to proceed further and integrate this and find out the position and all that. You can just compare this with cycloidal motion. So cycloidal motion till date, what you understand, it's the motion of a particle on the rim of a rolling object. Okay, so consider a rolling object like this and consider that at t equal to 0, but rolling means rolling with uniform speed. Okay, so that kind of thing. So its center of mass has a speed V0, and about the center of mass it has an angular speed V0 by r. And this is where it is at t equal to 0. And now consider the particle which is at the point of contact. So it's over here. So its initial velocity is 0. But you can see its initial acceleration is upwards. Because in the center of mass frame, what it's doing? It is doing circular motion. So it should have a centripetal acceleration. So you'll realize something very interesting, that this particle has an acceleration right now, which is like this, which is equal to V0 square by r, or r omega square. But its instantaneous velocity is 0. Then from here, it goes like this. So by the time in a second diagram, let's say your V has reached somewhere here compared to where it was here, let's say earlier. So now when it has reached somewhere here, let us say the point P has reached this point. So P has reached over here. There is the starting it was over here. So this was at t equal to 0. This is at some time t. So you can also see that your angular displacement during this time is this. This is your theta, and this is your linear displacement S. So the linear displacement is V into T. The angular displacement is omega into T. And now that particle has what kind of velocity? The velocity of that particle is the velocity of the particle with respect to the center of mass plus the velocity of the center of mass. And with respect to the center of mass, the velocity here, it is that omega cross R wala term. So it's doing circular motion in the center of mass frame plus Vc. So this omega cross R term is actually like this. It's this tangential velocity, like this. This R omega. Okay. So further, if we take this as our xy axis, so you'll see that this component, is R omega. Now you can see this is making theta with the vertical, so this theta will be like this. So its unit vector kya ho jayega? Its unit vector hoga minus cos theta I cap plus sine theta j cap. And the velocity of the center of mass will be V0 I cap, because that's continuing along the x-axis. So now you can see that this R omega is actually equal to this V0. So the velocity of that particle is like this. It is V0 into 1 minus cos omega t I cap plus V0 sine omega t. So it's exactly what we've got over here. That charge particle is having this kind of velocity. So that charge particle is having this kind of motion. It's moving like this. Alright, so now to track the motion of the charge particle, we can make use of the cycloidal motion's properties. So two important properties of the cycloidal motion that you should remember is that where the cycloidal motion starts, the acceleration is like this, and the magnitude of the acceleration is V0 square by r, but its initial velocity is 0. Okay. And where the cycloidal motion reaches the highest point, the speed is maximum, and that maximum is 2V0. But the acceleration is still the same in magnitude, but downwards like this. Now the acceleration is like this and equal to V0 squared by R. And also that this component of displacement, this Y max is equal to 2R. So if you're just able to compare this property for the cycloidal motion, which you know from mechanics, with the properties of that particle, which is moving in an electromagnetic field, then you can get these two things very easily, that what is the maximum speed the particle reaches during the cycloidal motion and what is the maximum displacement it reaches along the electric field. And later you just replace the electric field with the gravitational field. Okay. So I'm just minimizing this for a minute and you just make sure you understand the steps up to here. Then I'll tell you how to develop a shortcut to get these two things for the electromagnetic field, the maximum speed and the maximum displacement along the electric field. And in our question, that will be the minimum height actually from which we should drop it so that it turns before hitting the ground. So, Arman and Kritika, hope you are with me up to this point, clear up to here.
Sir, can you go
up? Sir, one doubt.
Yeah, just a minute. Arman, I have to go up?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Up to the differential equation or up to force?
Sir, up to force.
Okay.
Huh, so that's it.
This is the force, yeah. Yeah, Kritika, tell me.
Sir, mujhe wahan se doubt tha.
कहाँ से बताओ बेटा? फोर्स से?
नहीं सर, वो जहाँ पे आपने लिखा था कि Vx is equal to A into 1 minus cos omega t.
हाँ, okay, I'll come to that.
Sir, I have a doubt over
it. हाँ, ठीक है. So let's just go step by step. So what we have done here is we have understood that okay, at some instantaneous time when the particle is over here at this point, what is the force acting on it? Okay, so it is the combination. So if the instantaneous velocity is like this, and पहले we have understood why the velocity can't have a z component, है ना? Because electric force is always acting along the y-axis and magnetic force cannot act along the z-axis because field is on the z-axis. Okay? So whatever be the case, the motion is restricted to 2D and also the direction you can work out from cross product and all that is sort of this thing. So it's in the first quadrant rather than going off into the second quadrant or something. So I've taken the instantaneous velocity as some positive Vxi cap plus a positive Vyj cap. With that assumption, now I know that for this velocity, at this instant of time t equal to t, what is the net force acting on it? This is the net force acting on it. So then I have applied Newton's second law that net force is equal to mass into acceleration. And that acceleration equation I have divided into two components. So that is where my most critical step is coming. That my coupled differential equation, the x component of acceleration and the y component of acceleration is such that Ex depends on Vy and Ey depends on Vx. So whenever I have a coupled differential equation in mechanics or anything to do with motion, the way to solve it is this only, that differentiate one of the two equations and substitute. Now, which equation will be convenient to differentiate? The second one, because we'll get rid of the constant term, that QE naught by M will go away when we differentiate it. That's why I selected the second equation to differentiate. Technically, I could have differentiated the first one also, but the substitution would be a lot more tricky. So second wale ko maine differentiate kiya, QE naught wala term cancel ho gaya. Or Vx term is now converted to dVx by dt, which is coming in terms of Vy. So that is why my second derivative of Vy is now coming in terms of Vy, because dVx by dt. Okay. And that is showing me that it is ultimately this kind of term, that d2 Vy by dt square is proportional to minus of Vy. That means Vy itself must be what kind of a term? It must be a sinusoidal term. It doesn't mean SHM, because SHM comes up that displacement should follow this, that d2s by dt square is minus omega square s. Here we are not differentiating s, we are differentiating Vy twice. So it's telling me that Vy should have a simple harmonic character. That means Vy should alternate between some plus Vy and minus Vy with some kind of amplitude. So that amplitude we have taken as A0. So now this is the SHM step from here. So are you clear up to this step?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Kritika, you are also clear up to this step?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now your SHM analysis. See, so in an SHM, your dynamical equation gives you omega. So that we have got. So omega ka value mujhe pata hai, QV naught by M. But jo mere dusre terms hai, A and phi, wo kahan se aate hai? They always come from the initial conditions or what we call boundary conditions. So in this equation, substitute time as zero. So what is your Vy? It is A sin phi. And go back to your earlier diagram. And what was your starting velocity? It was zero. So Vy should be zero at time t equal to zero. So that means A sin phi should be zero. That means sin phi should be zero. So that's the first thing I know, that sin phi is zero. Then I also know that if I differentiate this term, I'll get acceleration. Acceleration is y component. So what is acceleration is y component? It is differentiation of this term. So it is A omega cos of omega t plus phi. Now in this equation, you put this thing as zero, time as zero. So you'll get the value of Ay at t equal to zero. So that should be how much? A omega cos phi. And you go back to your free body diagram. Initially, what was the net force? It was only QE naught. So what was your acceleration? It was QE naught by m. And that was along your y-axis. So you have your second term, that cos phi is first of all positive. And you can see that its value. So cos phi is positive and sin phi is zero. So the moment you know this pair, you know that phi is zero. Phi cannot be pi. Because had it been pi, then cos phi should have been minus negative quantity. So once you know phi is zero, you substitute this back in this equation. So you get this equation. That A omega into cos 0, which is 1. So A omega is nothing but QE naught by M. So from that, now you got your velocity amplitude E. So A is E naught by B naught. So now substitute this value of A and this value of phi in your original equation for Vy, this equation. So you're getting the value of Vy. Vy is A sine omega T, where A's value is this and phase constant is of course 0 and omega we had got earlier. Omega we had seen from earlier was this. So we have come up to Vy, right? This is clear. Now this itself is telling you that if you look at the projection of the motion on the y-axis, it is not an unlimited motion because your Vy is alternately positive and then negative, then positive and then negative. So that means it can't keep going like this. It's doing something like this. So it's doing up, down, up, down. So along the y-axis, the motion is like that, which is what you can also visualize in the in your what we call cycloidal motion. But we still don't have any information about Vx. So what we do, we go back to our equation 1 in the coupled differential equation. There it was that dvx by dt was directly proportional to Vy. And that proportionality was this one, qb naught by m. So in this, we substitute Vy on the right hand side. You know? So d by dt of Vx is A omega sine omega. No, because this term is nothing but omega. This term is nothing but omega. So this is now solved to get Vx as a function of time. So we have come up to this differential equation. So now just cross multiply and integrate. So cross multiply and integrate. So when you are integrating, you have this now. You have sine omega t integrated from 0 to t. So that will give you minus cos omega t upon omega from 0 to t. So now remember that cos 0 is 1. So that's how this term is there. This one term is there on putting the limits.
सर आपने बोला था कि Vy माइनस ए टू ए में जाएगा एंड देन Vx पर रेस्ट्रिक्शन नहीं होती सर
नहीं Vx इज नेवर बिकमिंग नेगेटिव नाउ सी व्हाट इज हैपनिंग ओवर हियर ए फॉर Vx सो व्हेन आई सॉल्व दिस डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन आई डोंट हैव cos ओमेगा t आई हैव 1 माइनस cos ओमेगा t यू अंडरस्टैंड
यस
तो Vx क्या हो रहा है Vx मेरा वेरी कर रहा है बिटवीन 0 एंड 2a यस
सर
गॉट इट ना एंड दैट So now think of your mechanics case. Na? In your cycloidal motion in mechanics, the x component of that particle's velocity, it never becomes negative. No? Yes. At the lowest point, it is 0. At the highest point, it is 2 V0. Then again, it is 0. Then again, it is 2 V0. So that's what's happening. Over here. So when I analyze this again, na, this when I write it as a velocity vector, it is some V0, let's say, which you can think of as your A over here, into 1 minus cos omega t I cap, plus V naught sine omega t j cap. That is what it as a is as a vector. So this reminds me that, okay, I've seen this somewhere before. Where I've seen this? I've seen this in this.
So I cross check it.
V naught into 1 minus cos omega t I cap. You know, that Vx which I did. Just a moment, I will get my charger. Yeah, so the first term beta is that Vx which I just did. You know, that Vx was this. So your first term in that equation is this Vx, which is matlab a ko bhi v naught likh lo. So it is some v naught into 1 minus cos omega t I cap, and E is again V naught, so V naught sine omega t J cap. So this is what my this thing is becoming.
Yes, sir.
Just a moment, okay. Just refresh the board once. So up to this step is clear now?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Now the moment we come to this step, now I stop applying electromagnetism anymore. I have understood, okay, the velocity of this particle is like this, and this is how all the terms are there, and I know how the terms depend on E and V. For example, that V naught is nothing but E naught, and that omega, so that V naught in this equation, which is basically our A from our region, the velocity amplitude, it is nothing but E naught by V naught. So that's where you know, the magnetic and electric field matter, and your omega is nothing but q v naught by m. So that is where the charge and mass ratio of the particle depend on this. So I know this is the role played by electric field and magnetic field. So this is done. Now I see that, okay, what kind of behavior this is showing me as far as the motion of the particle is concerned. So I see that, okay, it reminds me of something. It reminds me of cycloidal motion. So I go back and check in cycloidal motion kya hota tha, and I realize that in cycloidal motion, this is exactly the thing that happens. But only difference is V naught there is the velocity of the center of mass, and omega is the angular velocity about the center of mass. Here V naught is something that depends on electric and magnetic field, and omega is something that depends on Q by M ratio.
The cycloidal motion and helix motion,
yeah, helical motion is very different, but helical is a three-dimensional motion. Helical motion kab hota hai? When helical motion, best way to understand it is visualize a uniform circular motion in a plane, and now make that plane start moving. You're getting my point now. So imagine on the floor there's a particle that is doing uniform circular motion, and that floor is now coming up towards you. So how the path of that particle will look? It will look like a thing, you know, that thing. So helical motion happens in which situation? It happens in uniform magnetic field when you project a particle at an angle. So it has a parallel component and a perpendicular component.
Sir, अभी इसमें जो J कंपोनेंट में V naught sin omega t है ना, तो उसके कारण वो ऊपर नीचे एक लिमिट तक जा रहा है, एंड देन Vx में वो 0 और 2 के बीच में ही जा रहा है, तो फिर वो कंटीन्यूअसली आगे कैसे जा रहा है?
बिकॉज़ देखो ना, Vx इज नेवर बिकमिंग नेगेटिव ना, सो इट्स नेवर कमिंग बैक अलोंग द x एक्सिस, इट्स कंटीन्यूअसली गोइंग फॉरवर्ड. Vx इज बिटवीन 0 एंड 2 V naught. See the equation for Vx ना, is it ever a negative quantity?
No sir.
That's right. Got my point, na? So that is why the property of this motion is like this. The particle doesn't go like this. It doesn't go. It never comes back along the x-axis. It goes like this. So its y component is going up and down, but its x component is start stop like that.
Okay.
It never becomes negative. Stops and
stops. Okay, sir.
So abhi dekho, now for this question. Or this type of question, what we have to do is, we don't have time to sit and derive all this. You know? So we have to find a shortcut method to analyze this thing and to analyze this thing, the maximum displacement along the y-axis. So what trick we'll use is like this, that now in this very question, which is to do with electric and magnetic field, if I wanted to find out these two things, that the charge particle has started from here, okay, and it's going in a path like this, and I want to find out that what is this maximum I want to find out what is the maximum y displacement, what is the maximum speed, okay, and what is the acceleration at the point when it reaches the maximum speed. So what I do is I use the property of cycloidal motion, that yahan pe jitna bhi acceleration tha magnitude wise utna hi acceleration yahan par bhi hoga, और यहाँ पे जो स्पीड है वो मैक्सिमम स्पीड होगा. ओके, सो व्हेन वी रीचेस द वी मैक्स, दैट इज व्हेन माय वाई कंपोनेंट ऑफ डिस्प्लेसमेंट इज मैक्सिमम. एंड नाउ द फाइनल ट्रिक दैट आई विल यूज इज अगेन समथिंग हाइब्रिड, which we have not discussed till now in this, which is the work energy thing. Now think in terms of work energy, what is happening to the particle? Is the magnetic field doing work on it?
No.
No, no. So where this kinetic energy is coming from? It's coming from the work done by the electric field. Okay. So we will use a combination of three equations here. The change in kinetic energy is equal to the work done by the electric field only. Okay. So from going from the initial point to the highest point over there, okay, so initial to Y max. Okay, what is happening? The change in kinetic energy is plus half m V max square. Correct? And what is equal to the work done by the electric field? The electric force is QE naught upwards. So it should be the component of displacement upwards. Dot product will have to take F dot S. So F dot S mein kya aa jayega? QE naught into Y max aa jayega.
Yes.
Correct? Okay, so this is my first equation. This is the relation between V max and this thing. Now the second thing is that if you again go back to the diagram above, the acceleration at this point of time, the acceleration initially versus the acceleration at the highest point, they are the same but opposite in direction. Okay. So let's look at those two free body diagrams. So yahan pe u zero hai, so jo acceleration hai, that is purely what it is, electrostatic force QE naught divided by m. Now whereas when it reaches the highest point, there, what is happening? You have this V max and B is into the plane. So what is the direction of acceleration? It's downwards. But where it is coming from? It is coming from magnetic force downwards, electrostatic force upwards. And this combination is giving you the same magnitude of acceleration. Okay, it is giving you the same magnitude of acceleration which you had over here. So this magnitude of acceleration here should be the same. So yahan pe acceleration kya tha? It was QE naught by m. Wahan pe kitna ho jayega? It will be magnetic force minus electrostatic force divided by m. So it will be QV max. Into B minus QE naught divided by M. So this becomes my very powerful second equation. This, that this is equal to this. Clear up to this step, beta?
Yes.
Okay. So now you see you're done. You will find everything required from you. Because you have two V max and Y max, and you have two equations.
Sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, in first step, you have written QE naught by N. Then in second term, you have written QV max B naught minus QE naught by N.
Ah, so see the free body diagram, no? Better you will understand. That's why I made the FBD, no? The second one.
Okay.
Got it, no? Wahan pe kya ho raha hai? Highest point pe, ab velocity aisa hai, no? And magnetic field is going into the plane. So magnetic force is in this direction, downwards. Whereas electrostatic force is never affected by this, no? So what is the relation I have? Q by M cancel कर दो दोनों तरफ, so E naught is equal to V max into B naught minus E naught, and just cancel Q by M on both sides of this equation. So what I'm getting, V max is equal to 2 times E naught by V naught, and see that will relate to what we had seen in cycloidal motion earlier also. Because our V naught was actually E naught by V naught, and the highest point, the maximum velocity is this much. So this is what I'm getting from the second equation. Now substitute this in the first equation. So substitute in equation 1 and you will get the value of Y max. So substitute it there in this equation which we've just written earlier. I'll just minimize this little. So in this equation, you substitute the value of your V max. That's how much? 2 E naught by V naught. Okay. So half M into 2 E naught by V naught whole square should be equal to Q into E naught into Y max. So your maximum displacement will come out to be, on the left hand side you will have half into 4, so 2 E naught square, but E naught, so that will cancel out. E naught divided by, or into mass divided by Q V naught square. So this will become your maximum displacement. So the two unknown things which you are typically asked to solve in a problem like this, instead of the whole motion, because it's not a subjective exam, are these two things. And these two things you can just understand by remembering that it's cycloidal. You don't need to derive it. And using those two properties of the cycloidal motion, which I've listed. Okay. In the problem that I have given you, you just replace QE with what? MG.
MG.
And do the same analysis. Okay. And your Y max is the minimum height, basically.
So what we have to replace?
Yeah, so in that question, replace QE with MG. Electrostatic force for MG is a replacement.
Okay.
Yes, everything is the same.
Okay.
So this is an important type of, you know, trick while solving these questions. Okay. So that's where I will conclude today, people. Thanks for the extra time and waiting around with me. Okay. And just keep sending your doubts if anything else comes up in between.
Okay. Sir, is there any method nahi tha kya?
दो मेथड को हमने डिस्कस किया ना बेटा. I told you the fundamental method of solving the whole motion, and then I told you the trick method of comparing the motion with cycloidal motion and using that work energy trick and that acceleration trick.
Okay.
So these are the alternative tricks that you can apply to simplify the problem.
Okay.
But to simplify the problem, you have to remember कि वो cycloidal motion है, and you have to remember the properties of cycloidal motion. Without that, you will be clueless in the problem. There's no other thing that you can do.
Okay. And sir, what was that rolling trick you have used? R omega, a circular disc.
That is the, you know, the relative motion thing that I used. Huh? That particle with respect to the center of mass is doing circular motion, and the center of mass is going at uniform velocity. So that's why we superimpose the R omega and the VCM.
Okay. So what मतलब उसका trick आपने क्या यूज किया था?
वर्क एनर्जी
नहीं, वो जो सर्कुलर मोशन वाला जो भी था उसको आपने अप्लाई
कैसे किया? साइक्लॉइडल मोशन था. The thing that I explained in the rolling object, that only is called cycloidal motion.
Okay.
So that was the thing. Okay. So just go through the notes when I send it to you, and if you have any further doubts, you can get back to me about it. Okay.
Okay.
So bye guys, wish you all the best and stay in touch. Okay.
Thank you.